Hello everybody, I'm going to start today's class number 11.
Today, we are going to analyze the homeworks and use them to find the replication origin in a bacterial DNA. What do you need to know to pass this class? First, this is a course about computational thinking. These are four steps: decomposition, pattern recognition, abstraction, algorithm design. It's not about memory, it's about problem solving. So, in particular, the thing that you need to know is how to decompose and describe your solution in R. The key ideas, the key concept that you have to keep here are the for loops, while loops, we don't use them very much, but you can learn about them, conditionals, if else, and some practical things like turtle graphics, normal graphics, and how to process DNA. Now, what did we learn from our homework? First, you have to do some your solution first by hand. Try to do it manually to understand what is happening. Second, you write it in R and test it. When you write in R, be careful with the syntax. A lot of solutions were good ideas. I noticed that people understand the problem, but they don't work because they are not careful with the syntax. For example, the if command has two parts. There is a condition here inside the round parentheses and a command inside the curly braces. And the second important thing that is the subject of all the previous course is index. Indices and content are not the same. You are not your name. The name is a way to call something, but it's not the something. For example, you have a Kimlik. You are not your Kimlik. You are yourself. You are a person. Now, after you do this, you should try and see what happens. If it doesn't work, try again. What you really need to know is how to know when a solution is clear or not, when a program, when a description of a solution is clear or not. That is the main topic. Tomorrow, you are going to use a different computer language. You are going to program in we don't know what. You are going to talk with people from different countries, from different cultures, from different backgrounds. And the thing that you have to have in common is a way to explain what is happening. Now, homeworks are essential. It's the only way that we have right now to practice. We don't have a shared laboratory that we can try. You have to practice. This is not about memory, it's about practice. It is also the way that I can know what you are learning, what is good and what is bad, what needs feedback. At the end, doing the homework, delivering your homework on time will make you a better professional. Always deliver on time. If it is good, better. But the important thing is that you always deliver on time, no exceptions. Then it prepares you for the exam. We don't know yet how we are going to do the exam. Certainly, it's not like in previous years, but then it's going to be heavily based on the computer. So, the more you use the computer, the more prepared you are with using the computer, the better will be your exam. Now, this year, we are probably going to ask more conceptual questions. That means that you are going to need to speak English or to write English. We are going to probably ask to explain your solution in English or to explain someone else's solution. I may give you a program and you have to explain what is happening. You have to explain how you get to the conclusion. Unless you can prove a way that you are doing original work. It is essential that we can measure everybody's personal work here. We will be very strict with ethics. No illegal solution will be accepted. Okay? Okay, let's start with today's topic, analyzing DNA. So, as you know, DNA has two strands. The FASTA file that we download will have only one strand. That strand, we call it the forward strand. In fact, it's one of the two strands. There is no way to know which of the two strands we are looking, but we know that all the sequence that we are looking at are in the same strand. The other strand is not shown, but exists there and is automatically calculated. It's called the reverse strand. So one of the questions that we ask as homework is how to calculate the reverse strand. You know, of course, that Watson and Crick rules essentially mean that in front of every A you have a T, and in front of every C you have a G. Therefore, in the complementary strand, all A become T, all T's become A, all G's become C, and all C become G. Second point is that the second strand is reversed. The 5' become 3', and 3' become 5'. In other words, the strand is backwards. An initial idea for doing this code. Just be careful, there is something wrong here that we will discuss in a minute. But the basic point is this one. We have DNA as an input, and we have to check one by one each one of the letters. One by one essentially means here. We start with the first and we go until the last. The last position is the length of the DNA. So we will check every position in the DNA and we assign to the answer. Now you will notice immediately that we have two indices here. One for the output, that's a good idea that your output is sorted, is filled in order. I mean, your for loop should ideally be filling the answer from beginning to end. And then we calculate what is the position where we are taking data. So when we have the first letter in the answer, we have to check the last letter in DNA. That will be length of DNA minus 1 plus 1. We use J as an index for the input, and we use I as an index from the output. If the input is A, the answer is T. If the input is C, the answer is G, and so on and so on. The reverse part is doing by using this index. Now, what is wrong here? The first problem here is that we cannot use answer with a bracket if the vector doesn't exist. So here you notice that there is a bracket pointing to inside a object called answer, but the object answer was never mentioned before. To do it correctly, we need to use something to create. There are several ways to do, but the easiest way for us is to use this command. We are going to repeat an expression NA, meaning we don't know, and we are going to repeat for the proper size. That point is that it forces you to think what is going to be the correct size. In this case, what is the size? Well, we have a DNA input here, and our output has to be of the same length. Therefore, the size of answer should be the size of DNA. Okay, so both strands have the same length. Therefore, we know, even before we know the values, we know the size. First question, size. Second, values. This is the correct version. Here we have one extra line that says answer created from zero. So the first time you create the answer, there is no bracket. After you create it, you can use as many brackets as you like. Okay? If you have any question about this, please ask in the forum. And if you are not a student of this class, ask in the section of YouTube comments. So for testing, here we have a simple DNA, T-A-A-C-G-T, and the reverse complement, this T becomes an A, this G becomes a C, this C becomes a G, A becomes T, A becomes T, T becomes A. So if you have an answer similar to this, then you are fine. Otherwise, well, now you know the answer. It is important that people share their answers. After you finish the homework, or even during the homework, it is important that you discuss with your classmates, with your friends, how are you thinking, what are your options. This is not an exam. For the exam, work should be personal, but for the homework, work should be collective. Now, let's talk about DNA statistics. Statistics in general is counting. We have seen two DNA statistics that we care now, GC content and GCSQ. Question, what happens if you change one strand for the other? For example, we are using one of the strands for doing our statistic, but we know there are two ones. Are we wrong? Are we using the wrong strand? If you use the reverse strand, what happened with the GC content? What happened with the GCSQ? I give you a minute to think it, and I hope you get the correct answer. What happened is this. GC content doesn't change. Every C becomes G, every G becomes C. Therefore, the sum of G plus C doesn't change, and the percentage of G and C doesn't change when you change from one strand to the other. Therefore, when you get a FASTA file and you analyze the GC content of that sequence, it doesn't matter if you're using the forward or the reverse strand, you will get exactly the same value. Now, on the other side, if you change one strand for the other, then the GCSQ will change. How it will change? Well, G and C are going to interchange the roles, therefore the difference G minus C is going to change sign. If you have more G than C, now you have less G than C, and vice versa. Therefore, you only get a change of sign, but the content, the values, should be the same. Now, so far we are talking about global statistics, looking at the complete genome. As you saw in the homework, we also can do local statistics, meaning statistics that are only taking part of the genome. We say, technically, that we are looking through a window. A window is a part of the genome from an initial position and with a fixed size. For example, we can analyze a region with length 500 starting at position 3000. Well, a lot of people had problem with this question, which is surprising because we had it solved in the previous course. We use the function, well, there are more than one way, but the easy way to do is the function sec, which means sequence number, not DNA sequence, be careful. So sec has several options. We will discuss them in a minute. Let's show. Sec has several options, including from the initial value to, for a final value, by how much you should increment every type, and length, meaning how many elements you want to have. In this case, we know from where we are starting, and we know length, how many are. We want to increment one by one. That is the default, we don't need to say. So all options are optional, but not all at the same time. Okay, going back. So we have the function sec here from 3000 and from a length of 500. And we use this sequence, this vector of number, as an index of DNA. So the window here will be a vector of letters, because DNA is a vector of letters, and the content will be all the letters from start and from the length size. Choose careful what to do. Practice this section. Practice this function. Example. If you say from 5 to 14, you get exactly from 5 to 14. You can also say from 5 for 10 values. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 values from 5 to 14. They give you the same result. You can also say from 5 to 30, but instead by 3, like if you are counting columns. You get 5, 8, and you get the last number that is not exactly 30, but is the last number less or equal than 30. The next one will be 32, and that is certainly more than 30, so you don't get that one. Okay? So, again, this is a function that you have to keep in mind. Okay. Again, practice, and if you have any question, ask them in the forum. Okay, so we can use this to evaluate the GCSQ on different parts of the genome. We will traverse the genome, we will go around the genome with several windows of fixed size. Each window starts after the previous one, so they are not overlapped. You have one window here and the other one here immediately. In other cases, you will like overlap, but in this case, we are not taking any overlap. Okay, do you understand what is overlap, no? So, we create a vector with the window position. We have two vectors. One will give the start of every window, and the other will give you the content of the window. How we create the window position? Again, the same function, seq. This time we start from the very beginning of the genome until the last position. Last position minus size, because we don't want to get out. If you don't take this minus size, the last window will take out of the genome. And then every time we are going to increment by the window size. So for example, if your window size is 500, you will start from 1 to 500, then 501 to 1000, 1001 to 1500, and so on. And the last will be just enough to not fall outside the genome. Now we have the function GCSQ that we created before, and we can apply it to every element in the window position, and it will depend on the window size. And now we are going to see what is the effect of the window size. So, for example, here I have the result applied to the E. coli genome, and the windows are 100,000 letters. That means one with five zeros. So we have this interesting pattern that is common in bacteria, and it's relevant for us, it's important in molecular biology. The skew here depends on the position, because it's the skew of a window. In the first position, in the first 100,000, you have a value here near 0.4. The next is a little higher, lower, but they are all positive until suddenly they all start to be negative. And then again, it all began to be positive. What means is half of the genome has a positive GCSQ and other half has a negative GCSQ. And that is not random. Now, where is exactly the point when this number changed? Well, we don't know. This between the last positive number and the first negative number, there are 100,000 positions. That is a big jump. So we would like to make the window narrower. Let's make the window narrower, and we get this time 10,000. Every window is size 10,000, and here we see that the pattern is still valid, but things are not so clear. Now the every window has much more variability. Sometimes they go negative, but they are mostly positive until they are mostly negative, even if sometimes they are positive. So we say that this signal, this pattern, is much more noisy. If we keep reducing the window size and we go to 1,000, we get this pattern. You can still see that There is a first part that is mostly positive, then a second part mostly negative, and then again mostly positive. And if somehow we can know what is the limit between the positive and negative, we find it is somewhere here, and we were in our margin of error will be around 1,000. Finally, we can go to 100, and now it's very hard to see anything. It's very confusing. So we have this trade-off here. Let me put this way. If you want to see clearly, like in this window, you have to have window of 100,000. If you want to have more precision, you need narrower window, but then it's very hard to see. There's a trade-off, and it's not easy to fulfill. So how can we do? First, why do I want to do this? The reason why we want to do this is because this is connected to the DNA replication origin. Well, let's say the other way. We have seen clearly from this picture that the DNA changes GCSQ in one part of the chromosome versus the next one. Essentially, the chromosome is separated in two parts, one with a positive GCSQ and the other with a negative GCSQ. And the reason that this happens, and it's happening in all bacteria, is connected to the DNA replication. So we evaluated the GCSQ through all the genome, and we will find that this place that the DNA change sign is connected to the DNA replication. If you look at the literature, and here you have a nice example, you can find that there is a origin of replication, and while the DNA is replicating, you have two copies. Now, you know better than me, one of the strands is going 5 prime to 3 prime, and the DNA polymerase is going very efficiently here. The other one is going 3 prime to 5 prime. Therefore, it needs to have other enzymes, primases, and things like that, that are filling the second strand. In this process, the green strand, called here the leading strand, is being replicated very quickly and is not exposed to the medium. The lacking strand is exposed to the environment for a little longer time, and that essentially put it in risk of mutation. The typical mutation that happens is that this becomes C or the other way around. But the bottom line effect is that one of the sites of DNA has more G than C, and the other, the leading strand, has more G than C, and the lagging strand is more C than G. There is a nice video that you can see on your own copy. I'm not going to show it here. And now we are going to find the origin using this. So to find the origin, essentially, we need to find the place where the DNA change sign. The origin of replication is one of the places where the DNA change sign. Of course, there are two places where this leading and lagging strand meet. One is the origin of replication here, and the other is the terminus. Well, these two places will be identified by this chain of sign and the GCSQ, but we are going to discuss later how to identify each one. Okay, how we find the place where the strand change sign? We want to write a program that can do it in many different places. So there are many important biological questions that you want to ask. Are both sides of the chromosome of the same size, both replicors of the same size? If they are different, why it's happening? Do you have an insertion? Do you have a mutation? Do you have extra genes? Sometimes you can detect some viral infection because one of the replicors is bigger than the other. Okay, so finding the change of sign is not so easy as we see, because the sign is noisy. There is a better way to do, and this is the key idea of today's class. Instead of calculating directly the skew, we want to calculate a new value that is the sum of all the skew that we have seen so far. So we start with accumulated skew equal to the first one. Then will be skew 1 plus skew 2. Then 1, 2, and 3. So at the position I, the accumulated skew will be the skew in the position I plus the previous one plus the previous, all the previous one. So now, instead of looking for the change of sign, we are going to look for the minimum and maximum. Let me show you how it happened. In this plot, we are using window of size 10,000, and we have graphed both graphic together. The center line is the GC skew. As we saw before, you have some noisy signal, and it's mostly positive, and then it becomes negative. Mostly negative, you still have a lot of noise. But if you look at the second line, which is the accumulated skew, you will find that while the skew is positive, the accumulated is going up, because essentially we're adding positive numbers. Then when the skew changes sign, and most of them are negative, we're essentially taking out numbers, subtracting numbers. That means that the accumulated skew is going to go down, and will continue to go down until, again, the skew change sign. When the skew change sign to positive, then this line is going to be positive again. Therefore, the key points here are the maximum and the minimum of the accumulated skew. And finding maximum and minimum are much easier than finding where this skew change sign. So it's a good idea. So what is accumulative? Accumulative, it's a word that essentially means that we are going to keep adding and adding all the value that we get together. This is a super important idea, and is the idea that we are going to follow in the following classes. An accumulative sum can be seen as balance. So for example, every day you have some flux of money. Sometimes you get money, marked here with blue, and sometimes you only spend money. So, just for an example, the first day I got 500 liras, let's say, and then I spent something on food, something on transport, maybe I got a big dinner, and after some days I get another 500 liras, I spent during the week, and I get another. So this is the movement of money. Money coming in is positive, money going out is negative. And we want to know how much money do you have in the pocket every day. How you do that? Essentially, you accumulate the income is the money that you get positive or you expend when it's negative. The balance is the total money that you have. Obviously, the first day, the only money that you have is the money that you get as an income. If you're the first day here, you get 500. That is your income for the first day, in a sense, so the balance of the next day, the first day. The next day, the balance follows this pattern. The balance of today is the balance I had yesterday plus whatever money I got today. Let's say it again. The money that I have today is equal to the money that I had yesterday plus whatever money I get in minus whatever money I get out. If I get paid, my balance increases. If I spend money, my balance reduces. Income and balance here are going to be vectors. Since they have different values every day, we will represent with an index. Here I'm using I as the index. And the balance So the income, so I will be the money that comes in and out on day I, and the balance will be the money that you have in your pocket the day I. The vector represents the money all days. The element income sub I is the value for a single day, the day I. Okay? So we were going to represent days with the letter I, and it's useful for think. It's useful to think as this. It's useful to think that I represent today and I minus one represent yesterday. If we know our income, we can calculate balance. How we do this is very easy, and we are going to do it many, many times. The balance of the first day is very easy because, as we say, the only money that you have the first day is the money of your income. The balance on the next day is the balance of today, is the balance that you had yesterday, plus the income on today. Graphically, this looks like this. The same idea applies to GCSQ. You can think that the GCSQ in each window is the income in GC, and we want to see the accumulative SQ, that is equivalent to the balance of money. The first accumulative SQ is equal to the SQ of the first window, and then for each one of the windows, you have a SQ in each window, and we calculate the accumulative in position I equal to the accumulative in the position I minus 1, meaning yesterday, plus the SQ that you get in that particular window. It's the same pattern and got the same solution. Again, let's look back. This is the way that we will calculate with money, and this is the way that we calculate with skew. Can we write this as a function? Now, minimum and maximum show where is the change of sign. If you know how to calculate the accumulated sum, we can find the origin essentially looking for minimum and maximum. How we do this? Well, it is important, and this is a common error in many exams, that you don't confuse the value of the maximum with the position of the maximum. If you look with the function max, it will tell you the value of the maximum, and it's not what we get. What we really care is about the position of the maximum. How you get that? With this function. The function whichMax tells you which is the index of the maximum between the first and the last position of accumulative skew. Since ACSQ vectors have the same size as win position, essentially, we can use this index to index inside win position. Just be careful here. Here is one way that people get confused. Which max will give you an index, not a value. We use this index to look inside the vector of window position. This window position is in unit of base pair. So now we know that the origin of replication of E. coli is around 1,540,000 base pairs. Of course, it depends on the size of the window. The location of the origin depends on the window size. The origin will be somewhere between the position indexed by the maximum of the cumulative skew and the same number plus window size. If we reduce the window size, the pattern is still valid. It's a good idea. So here we have a window of size. How much is this? It's hard to see. 10,000. Now we go to window 1,000. That will give us better resolution. We will be able to pinpoint more precisely what is the replication origin. And we can even do 100. You see the signal gets more and more noisy, but the cumulative skew keeps the same shape. And finally, we can go window size 10 and even window size 1. Here I am. You cannot see anything at the GC skew, at the skew level, but the cumulative skew is clearly marked here. There is a maximum and there is a minimum. So we can do it with the resolution of one base pair. You can even pinpoint exactly where is the point that this curve stops growing and starts going down. And that will be exactly where the negative point happens. Okay. Finally, we have to say that cumulative sums are useful. If we know the income, we can get the balance. If we know the skew, we can get the accumulative skew. If we know the change of something, we can know the state of something.
And this is going to be the idea that we are going to follow in the next classes. This is super important. It's essentially the base of system biology and the base of understanding how things change. We are going to use this to model complex systems, and of course, is the way that we are going to use to model infection like a coronavirus infection. So, as usual, ask questions. I hope you have a lot of questions. If you don't have questions, it means that we are not teaching hard enough. So ask questions and see you next class.